Well, I'm so excited to be here with all of you today, principally because I feed off of people's inspiration, kind of like an inspiration vampire. And very few, it's true, and very few groups of people are as inspirational as you are. And I have to say, even just yesterday, giving the workshop that I gave about gamification, it was a tremendously energizing, and so I'm very much looking forward to the session later on today and interacting with more of you about the cool stuff that you get to do. So I want to start off by talking about this word, gamification. To many of you, have heard it, you know, and to some extent, it sort of feels like the new black. And I'm a transplant from Canada to New York via San Francisco, so now I have to do fashion-related metaphors whenever I talk about things. I don't do finance ones, I only do fashion ones. And so the real question is, why now? Why is gamification a thing now? I mean, if you think about it, Hollywood's been talking about gamification for a really long time, right? If you remember, those of you who are millennials, you won't, but there's this movie called War Games from 1983 with Matthew Broderick. It's a movie all about playing games in the real world. Hollywood has loved the story, the intersection of games and culture. The military has long since been using games, not just in the War Games kind of sense, but in fact, the US military is one of the most advanced users of games or gamification concepts. And certainly, I'm sure almost every one of you right now in your pocket has one of these buy 10, get one free punch card style things. I actually have one from the amazing Ronnie Brook Dairy in New York. I have approximately 100,000 calories worth of milkshakes in my pocket right now. If you can see the evidence here, but the proof is in the pocket. And these buy 10, get one free concepts or more evolved loyalty programs are a form of gamification thinking, you know, that has existed in business before us. But what's really happened, what's most substantial about the advent of gamification today is that fundamentally, people are changing. And I know that this is sometimes hard to really absorb. We've had a great presentation about millennials. I'm going to talk about them too. But there are real changes afoot in our demography. In the United States and in Europe, 126 million plus people are millennial. That's a large group of people. I'm going to quantify it. And these 126 million millennials, as you've so eloquently heard, are very different. The evidence of their change is not as far away from you as you might think. Here, a list of the most popular programs in the United States today. If we measured games the same way, if we measured television programs and games the same way, which isn't actually a good metric since games are much more engaging than TV in general, 3 of the 5 top non-special programs in America today are social games on Facebook. The largest program in America today is Farmville. If you include game shows on television, 5 of the 5 top non-special programs in the United States are games already. People love games. Americans love games. We've always loved them. And the effect of those games is farther reaching and reaches further into your world than you might think. Primal Shah, the founder of Kiva, one of the great successes in do-goodery in our lives, when asked recently who his number one competitor was, he said, Zynga, the company that makes Farmville, which seems sort of a counterintuitive thing for somebody who's out to change the world to say is a competitor. But what Primal understands, which is inherent in the sort of millennial demographic shift, is that we are all competing for the attention of people in their optional lives. The actual required obligatory element of your life is pretty small. It's get up, go to the bathroom, feed yourself, take your kids to school, go to your job, come home, that's it. Everything else that happens in your day is optional. And we are all competing for that optional time in the consumer's mind, no matter what it is that we do. We used to think volunteerism was different from TV watching. It turns out it's a level playing field. And some companies understand this better than others. Gamification is already transforming certain businesses from, you know, Foursquare, which really made a mobile social networking industry vertical happen for the first time using game mechanics over the previous versions like Dodgeball, which were not super successful, lacked that engagement, to companies like Zynga, which depend on the concept almost entirely for fun. I mean, I'll just posit this to you about Farmville. Let me say I was describing a game to you, And in the game, you had to till some soil, plant some seeds, hope that the rain came or water your plants, wait for them to go, harvest them, take them to market, sell them, recruit some other people to build a farm community. Does that sound like fun to you in any way? Right? No, that's Middle Ages serfdom. That is the... it is the work that our forefathers gave up so we could be here in Monterey today talking about sustainability. It is not something that intrinsically sounds like fun. And it proves a critical lesson about gamification and about game mechanics in general. It's not the theme that makes something fun. It's the mechanics that make something fun. We can take almost any concept and turn that into an experience that is engaging and fun if we understand human psychology and motivation and understand how to use the powerful tools of games to make that happen. And Zynga, Nike, JP Morgan Chase, Coke, you know, and a ton of other companies, some of whom we'll talk about today, have some great examples for you. Most importantly about this whole trend of gamification is we're not able to go back. And nor would we want to, really. I mean, just as an example, this, I'm holding an iPhone up in my hand. This is a pretty shitty phone. As a phone, right? I'm not singling out AT&T people in the room. But this is a pretty crappy phone. It's pretty bad. But we can't go back to the great phones that we used to have. We can never go back. This is a one-way valve. It's a one-way street. I'm never going to have that Motorola StarTAC again. Motorola StarTAC was a really good little phone. We can never go back. We can't go back. And so we can only go one way. And that means that people's expectations of what's fun, of what's engaging, of how a system or a product or a company or a brand needs to interact with them has been profoundly, indelibly, and forever transformed by games. And that is the leading edge, the thin edge of the wedge about gamification and why it matters. And so let's have a little definition about it, because I'm sure many of you came into the room thinking about these different ideas. Gamification is the process of using game thinking and game mechanics to engage audiences and solve problems. And critically, it's a process. We don't just arrive magically one day and throw some like game sauce on top of your thing, and all of a sudden it's gamified and we're done. There's no game layer. There is no game whipped cream in a can. There is no game easy cheese. There is none of that. I never really understood how hard cheese was until I found easy cheese. There's none of that, though. I've never eaten that stuff, by the way, ever. Okay. So number one, it's a process. It's a process of taking your products, services, ideas, and brands and transforming them using the techniques of games. It's also about game thinking and game mechanics as two separate ideas. And I'm going to show you some examples today of things which are both great examples of game thinking, which is just the process of being influenced by games over the course of our lifetime, and game mechanics, which are the tools that game developers use. I'm 37 years old. I sat down at the 1980 question. And I'm 37. I'm the oldest cohort of people who grew up with video games as an omnipresent part of my life. Today, and that's just affected the way that I think about things, right? I mean, think about Shakespeare, for example. If Shakespeare was a real person, which we're not sure, he famously said, "All the world is a stage." But if he were alive today, he'd probably say, "All the world's a game," right? Because it's just a better metaphor for thinking about things. That's kind of game thinking in its purest sense. The trend itself has broader implications and is starting to be quantified by important people, and so it's important for us to also understand what that means. Gartner Group's recent research about gamification says that by the year 2015, 50% of all innovation in the global 2000, the world's 2,000 biggest companies, will be driven by gamification. And 70% of those companies at the same time will be running full-blown gamified apps inside their organizations. It's tremendous. M2 research forecasts that in the US, that's about $1 billion worth of spending on the products, services, and technologies to make a gamier and more fun future happen. So you heard a little bit about me. I'm Gabe Zickerman. I'm the author of two books, Game-Based Marketing, which came out last year, and the upcoming Gamification by Design, published by O'Reilly. I am also the editor of the Gamification blog. I advise and mentor a whole bunch of companies. I talk about this topic all the time. I have a lot of fun doing what I do, which is cool. Here are some of the companies involved in gamification, broadly speaking, some of whom I work with and some of whom I don't, but are awesome and will share some examples. And I'm also the chair of an event called Gamification Summit, which brings together interesting thinkers on the subject. So let me give you a few examples that hopefully will provide you with some inspiration today and over the next few days as you go forward and engage with the topic of building sustainability. And we have a 3 o'clock session as well that you can attend if you want to go into this in more detail. So, the first example I want to share with you It was designed by a good friend of mine, a guy named Kevin Richardson, who works at MTV in San Francisco, called Speed Camera Lottery. How many of you know what a speeding camera is? Yes? Okay, so you drive by a speeding camera, you go over the limit, it takes your picture, sends you a bill in the mail. That's a speeding camera. Now, in many of the Nordic countries, the ticket that you get is not based on how fast you're going past the speeding camera, but how much money you make. So the more money you make per year, the bigger the bill. So like you could get a $100,000 bill if you're like the CEO of IKEA or something. So it's true. Although technically they don't make any money if you understand their corporate structure, but I digress. So it's true, it's weird, it's true. Okay, so what Kevin did the most brilliant, perfect concept in speed camera lottery. So instead of an outsized, abstract, impossible to predict ticket that you get when you drive by the speeding camera, if you drive at or under the speed limit past the speed camera lottery cameras, you are entered into a drawing to split the proceeds of the people who speed. Game thinking in its purest form. Take an abstract, giant, negative reinforcement loop and break it into a series of actionable, trackable, followable, positive reinforcement steps that get a user to change their behavior. Awesome, right? In 1 week, a 20% reduction in speed at the checkpoint. With no pedagogy, okay? No like commercials on TV, no like, you know, flyers, no people standing there going, slow down, slow down, slow down. None of that, just a big thumbs up or thumbs down and the word speed camera lottery at the thing. Incredibly, incredibly powerful ideas and a great example of game thinking. Another example that overlaps with many of the things that you guys do is now starting to be seen on the dashboards of hybrids, plug-in electric vehicles. These are in-dash games designed to help people drive more ecologically. And I don't know if you've seen this, but it's become basically de rigueur that you cannot launch a hybrid or battery electric car in the United States and in Europe without having some kind of in-dash game, and they're awesome. If you know the basic concept of a game like Tamagotchi or a virtual pet game, effectively they're like this. Like in the case of the Ford Focus or Fusion, there's a green plant that grows on the dash, the more ecologically you drive. And then when you don't drive ecologically, the plant kind of dies and thins out. It is a simple kind of feedback loop, a very, very simple game, really simple, right? No one even thinks of that as being like a video game style game, but it's a very simple virtual pet style nurturing game to help people drive more ecologically. The new one from the Nissan Leaf is actually going to be a Facebook connected game so you can compare your driving against your friends. What's amazing about this, I don't know if people are here from the automotive business, but what's amazing about this is a spontaneous $100 million bet on the power of games to change behavior. This wasn't driven by the government. This wasn't driven by consortia, though I love consortia. This wasn't driven by like any like clear-cut, you know, marketing strategy up front, but a sort of spontaneous game-centric change in design. It costs a lot of money to design a real-time game, folks, and retool dashboards to put it in there. This is not cheap. This is not a small bet. This is a big bet that these games help drive the sale of hybrids and make people more connected to the core value proposition of the car that they bought. Another really sort of interesting example that comes out of this is something that actually Google has worked on. And in Google's travel and expense department, like most large corporations, they have a lot of travelers and they spend a lot of money, people traveling around the world. So typically, if you've ever worked in one of those environments, you'll know that most people try to game that travel and expense system. It's like, okay, if the Four Seasons is on the plan, I'm staying at the Four Seasons, I'm not staying at the, you know, Marriott Suites. So what Google did was they reformed their travel and expense system to make it more like a game. Instead of just getting your, you know, hotels in plan, airlines in plan, all that, you get a per diem and you get a per city kind of maximum. And then any amount of money that you spend that's under the cap for the trip that you're about to take, you can do one of three things with. You can use it to upgrade a future trip, so make a trip to New York, let's say, more lush than it was originally planned. You can donate it to charity, or you can bank half of it and take that at the end of the year. Now, it's an extraordinarily small intervention from a design standpoint, right? This is not some humongous, complex rethinking of travel and expenses, very small, with little leaderboards. It has had a tremendous effect at Google. Google employees like talk about travel and expense management. Do you work at a company where people get together and go, hey, you know what? I know a cheap place for you to stay in Philadelphia near the airport so you can save some money. Like, that doesn't happen. But Google's done it, and by extension, many of these things have a tremendous benefit in the reduction, you know, certainly in terms of the ecological footprint. Another example, I know there's some folks from Target here. Target has this game that cashiers play while they're checking you out that gives them very subtle kind of basic feedback about how well they're checking you out compared to the time standard. And it would seem like, and it's not attractive in a game sense in any way, except that what you find very quickly is that checkout people don't necessarily feel very engaged with their jobs in real time. So even this little tiny feedback system that they can master, that they can figure out how to improve their score and get the like the right outcome, improves their job satisfaction, improves their engagement with the work, makes them happier, and makes them much more efficient, which you can imagine translating to other kinds of employee-based interventions that are not just a checkout. And last but not least, I want to share one of the most amazing stories with you as a point of inspiration for you. And this is the New York City-based company NextJump. And NextJump makes incentive programs for small companies. They've got a few hundred employees based in four offices. And the CEO, who you can see standing there on the treadmill, total fitness freak, okay? Like, every time we talk, I'm always like, oh, this guy thinks I'm really fat. But it's cool, it's cool. He never lets on directly, but I know. But he's an awesome, he's an awesome guy, total fitness freak. So he wanted his employees, he wanted his 20-something, mostly 20-something employees to work out more. So he built a little check-in app, right? And put a gym in every office. First they built, put a gym in every office. He wanted people to work out more. Built a little check-in app, said, okay, that you guys check in, you go to the gym, you work out, you check in, the top exercisers of the year will split a pot of money, about 20,000 bucks, the top five or six guys will split a $20,000 pot, and he got about 12% of his employees to work out, which is a really, really good number in and of itself. And then he decided to try a little experiment and change the game. And so he allowed the employees, he forced the employees then to, instead of being tracked individually, to form teams. And the teams were based on the geography that they were in mostly, so office by office competition with a simple sort of leaderboard, but you could form any kind of team that you want. And in the change from switching to an individual game to a team game, NextJump now gets 70% of its employees to work out on a regular basis. 7-0. And for those of you economics majors in the room, you'll recognize that expected cash return went down from game A to game B, right? More people to split the pot, the amount of possible money you could win actually went down. So what's really exciting about it is another game mechanic, team play or cooperative play, can have a powerful effect on behavior modification. 70% of a company working out, folks, is one life saved, by the way. That's one person's life saved in that group, statistically, in terms of who's gonna die from a heart attack from not working out. So with that, I wanna encourage you to, I wanna encourage you guys as much as possible to think about great ways that you can incorporate game thinking. Notice a lot of the examples that I gave you were not like real video gamey style examples. For you to incorporate game thinking and game mechanics into the work that you do. And I encourage you to reach out to me on Twitter if you want to keep having a conversation, or come see us at 3 o'clock for our more in-depth gamification session. And so thank you very much. I appreciate your time.